Good afternoon, everybody. Looks like you're going to speak English today, which is good. Thank you, Tom, for being here. Thank you, University of Aveiro, and especially CELS for promoting this event. Just to say that ArtShare, as possibly you all know, is a company dedicated to research and development, but we particularly focus on researching within development of humanities, but on the research and development of technology concerned to people, concerned to make people interact. And therefore, that's why we are here in University of Aveiro. We're running a project called Skill Art. That's a project that's been running for almost 3 years now. And I got a microphone. That project is why we are located at University of Aveiro at the incubator. It's been quite a pleasure to do it and to be here. So about Tom, I don't think Tom really needs introduction. He's been involved and engaged with Portugal for a long, long time. He's been engaged with, especially recently, with Guimarães European Capital of Culture. To which he's now the programmer for the cities or the city itself, which is a very important area because of the engagement of population within the new structures that the European Capital is bringing. What we thought was really interesting on bringing Tom here was, first of all, that he has an experience of our territory. Second of all, he has a really huge experience with creativity and creative industries and cultural industries and all that's related with art and creativity all over the world, not only in England, but all over the world. And especially because we are interacting a lot with technologies and we have this engagement with technologies to promote human interaction, it seemed to us quite a good opportunity in the phase that the country is facing now to try to make international our products and our services and our ideas. It would be interesting to see how can we engage creative industries and creativity in the development of technology, especially in the context of the TIS, the Poll for Competitiveness that is based in Aveiro, which has the function to promote all the sort of development that we are very specialized in Portugal to the world. So I think that's it. I'm sorry if I was too long. Tom, go ahead.
Thank you, Lewis. You make me feel really quite embarrassed now, because you said I've been working in Portugal for a number of years, and here we are standing doing a workshop and event in English. It really puts me to shame that I still haven't managed to grasp the language almost beyond buying a beer and asking for the bill. Having said that, I do feel like, you know, I'm getting, you know, really rich experience from working in a Portuguese context, and particularly in a northern Portuguese context, and working with partners across the arts and cultural sector, but also working increasingly, I think, in terms of the wider role of arts and culture in society. So looking at the relationship with the economy, looking at how we plan the regional competitiveness for the north of Portugal, and grappling with, I guess, what the future might hold for this region and for the country as a whole, and what kind of economy and society we might be building here. And obviously, since I've been here, we've had the crisis as well, so there's, you know, the questions that we're seeking answers for are rather more powerful than perhaps they were a few years ago when we were perhaps in a relative comfort zone. Thank you for all coming this afternoon, this evening. It's a real privilege to be here. Thank you to the university for having me, and thank you to Lewis and his team and everybody else who's played a role in making this happen, and also putting together what looks like a really rich program. I understand we're being streamed live online, which is great, because that means hopefully I can see any other events that are happening. Unless this isn't the last one, is it? No, so I can tune in later on then and see what else is going on. I'm just going to try and get this up and running, if I may. One second. I should be with you in a... Are we while? Okay. I need to make sure I'm not standing in the way of this for the next 20 minutes. Okay, so I think, as Lewis said in the introduction, I'm not a technologist. I used to be an academic, but I kind of sort of jumped out of the academy for different reasons a few years ago. But I work very much at the kind of crossroads of different sectors. I work with the creative economy, I work with the arts sector, I work with education institutions, I work with municipalities, etc. And ultimately, this is tied to those big questions around how we plan for a competitive economy in the future, how do we nurture most effectively our talent base on the basis that the talent that we have is our real raw material, our real potential, and how we leverage the things that are distinctive about us, our cultural identity, our sense of place, our social capital, our knowledge. How do we make that into something that ultimately does things like creates jobs or enhances competitiveness or creates different kinds of value to society? So the title of my presentation really is just to provoke really a discussion around how in an institution such as a university or in other institutions like across the arts and cultural sector, how do we support creative talent to flourish? How do we develop the enabling conditions for people to make the most of their skills, their ambitions? And how do we do that in a way that is generous and open and engaging rather than done to, rather than didactic, rather than too official, too structured? I don't need to introduce myself because I've already had two introductions, so I'll move beyond this existential question as to who am I. And you can visit the website. Suffice to say that, as I said before, I kind of move between different kinds of projects and I'm kind of sector neutral. But I'm critically interested in how creativity is something that joins together different strategic agendas. And I want to talk to you a lot today about how actually it's something that's often designed out of processes such as education or planning, rather than something that should be at the heart of how we deliver our services, how we develop our institutions, and how we develop places. As Lewis said, I work quite a lot internationally. I've just come back from Nigeria 24 hours ago via the UK, so it kind of gives me a different perspective perhaps on things. It also makes me quite exhausted half of the time as well, so hopefully I'll be able to keep the energy levels up for you. And also, as Lewis mentioned, I'm also working in Gimaranj, which I still haven't managed to pronounce effectively after all of these years. So I just try and pronounce it differently each time, so I might be right some of the time. And I'll introduce to you some of the projects that we're developing there, because it is a really good excuse, from my perspective, to try stuff out, to do things that normally wouldn't be possible, and to cut through the kind of boundaries that normally get in the way of interesting practice. Okay. So how do we nurture creative entrepreneurship? How do we make sure our talent has a platform from which to express itself and to engage with the range of knowledge, technologies, services, etc., that are so important for it to make the most of itself? And I guess, like in any presentation that can have a kind of long, circuitous path, I would advise you to, if there's anything you want to take away from this, just take away three things. So you can stop listening until the conclusion now, because there's just three things that I broadly want to say to you today. One is that creative entrepreneurs flourish in open, collaborative environments. So the idea that you can develop something that's very specific and that sort of operates outside of the normal system is, I think, a defunct proposition. We need to find integrated, holistic approaches to supporting our creative talent at the heart of our cities and our institutions. Secondly, they're all one. Secondly, the institutional ecology is not fit for purpose. So apologies in advance if I offend anybody, but the universities are still struggling to keep up with delivering the kind of enabling environment that our talent requires and ultimately deserves. Municipalities don't even go there. They're so slow and lack the flexibility required. And ultimately, the kind of partnerships, the kind of funding mechanisms, all of those things are still running to catch up with what we need to deliver for the sector. It doesn't mean it's impossible, but it means it's very difficult to provide the kind of environment that we need. And thirdly, we do need new spaces, new platforms, new applications. This is not just about adapting what we have. We need to actually break through and to create totally new kinds of service, new kinds of platform, new kinds of space, if our talent is to make the most of itself, or if we're to make the most of it. Now, over the last 10, 15 years, there was a lot of discussion on how we become more interdisciplinary, how we become more collaborative, how we develop things that are much more about the interstices or the convergent areas between different sectors. But I think we've just been tinkering with that. I think we've just been playing with that so far. And we haven't genuinely, except with a very small number of examples, opened up our institutions to be much more enabling of the kind of flows of ideas and experiences and knowledge that our talent requires if it's to grow sustainably and if it's to develop new business models, new activities that in turn can turn around our economy. I think we're still benefiting from phases of innovation and creativity that actually almost happened a generation ago, and we're yet to create a new paradigm which in turn will be delivering business models that we benefit from in a generation's time. So we need to open up our institutions. We need to create new relationships based on equal peer relationships between people who historically wouldn't have ever met each other or worked with each other. And we need to do that for at least three things. One is to grow the economy. Second is to develop the kind of churn in the economy you need for it to grow sustainably. And thirdly is to develop those USPs, those specialisms, those things that can differentiate here and other places from other places. So when you think about what is distinctively possible here, and not to replicate elsewhere, but to develop something that harnesses the combination of assets that we have in this part of the country and this part of the world. So at the heart of that are these people called creative entrepreneurs. Now, I wouldn't suggest that these are people who just sit within the creative industry sector. These are people who are entrepreneurial, but they are also driven by creativity. They have a spirit of creativity. They could be scientists, technologists, public servants. But generally, they tend to be situated somewhere within those creative industries, those creative arts, you know, from design through to visual arts, through to performing arts, through to music, through to fashion. Because they're the people that, on a daily basis, are trying to utilise their kind of creativity as a means to get by, to live, to eat, and to prosper. So, creative entrepreneurs. I'm going to just take you on a kind of little caricature journey now to stereotype some of the things that make, that notionally separate creative entrepreneurs from other kinds of entrepreneur. And in turn, that will introduce questions as to how we actually support creative entrepreneurs to flourish and as to whether our institutional offer in the universities, in our arts centres, etc., whether that is fit for purpose for supporting creative entrepreneurs to flourish. So the stereotypes. First of all, creative entrepreneurs are often schooled in the creative arts first and business second. So does anybody here go to art school or design school or a couple? Yeah. Did you have any management training or business training when you went there? So small, you're nodding emphatically, so you're disproving my stereotype here. You're not supposed to. You're supposed to come out without having a clue about business and not knowing anything about management and all that sort of stuff. I think there has been a change. I would argue it hasn't gone far enough. But I think there has been an under-integration of creativity and business. And graduates are often coming out of the art school without an understanding about how you turn that creativity, that process, into sustainable businesses, or also how you work with other sectors, how you collaborate, how you connect your knowledge with other people's knowledge. So there's often an imbalance in the kind of business profile for creative entrepreneurs. And actually, the entrepreneur comes second, the creativity comes first. These are stereotypes. There are issues, obviously, around mobilizing yourself to translate your creativity into business. There are issues, there are practical issues around the intangible assets of a creative person versus more tangible assets of another kind of business where you can almost pin down and measure the value of what you're doing. Those create issues in terms of how you leverage the potential of your creativity to develop businesses. And there are also, I guess, these are kind of almost romantic stereotypes about how creative people, you know, they're a bit flouncy, they're not punctual, they're unreliable, all of that kind of stuff. You know, most of it's bogus. And when it's true, it's almost because it's socialized to become true. And partly they're educated to be like that. And, you know, it becomes a kind of fait accompli. So that's one stereotype. Second, though, is the absolute dependence on creative people, creative entrepreneurs, for content, for stimulation, for ideas, for travel stories, for things that stimulate the imagination. And to do that, you need to be connected, either directly in terms of face-to-face relationships or indirectly in terms of, you know, obviously exploring the kind of digitally enabled social paradigm that we're in today, where, you know, without our network, we are nobody. Now, creative people have been, in many ways, at the sharp end here. They've been more explorative. They're often driven by a hunger for those new encounters that have become so mainstreamed in the rest of the business world. And I think it was people working in the creative industries who actually were the kind of pioneers when it came to a lot of things that we see now in terms of social media and social networks more generally. And partly this is an absolute survival technique. Because if you're a small micro creative business just come out of the academy, you need to connect to survive. You need to build as many relationships as possible because they are the people that supply you with the ideas, the content, the stimulation, but also they're potentially the market. So creative businesses are absolutely dependent on those social networks. They're much more portfolio driven. They're much more promiscuous. They have to be to survive. They have to build teams, but they have to be part of teams. And they have to be in several teams at the same time. So in a sense, a stereotype is that means you have no direction in your career. You're kind of moving around in a very promiscuous way. You're hungry for new types of relationship and you never cement and make the most of the ones that you're already in. But actually, maybe that's a necessary evil for stimulating your creative mind. Okay, it's moving faster than I wanted it to. So notionally, on the left-hand side, the more standard linear approach to business planning that you might have in sectors outside of the creative industries don't necessarily apply to that sector. And that's a necessary, circuitous approach to success, where you gather relationships and you build ideas through collaboration. So creative entrepreneurs, to build on the stereotype here, have to be promiscuous, have to be socially connected, and they have to be agile. They can't sit still, they need to move, they need to make new relationships. They need to work across different sectors. That means they have to be increasingly interdisciplinary in the way that they work. They can't work in an isolated way. And I was talking to Lewis earlier on, he was telling me the difference between being interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary and transdisciplinary. So I've learned something new today as well. And actually it made me think that creative entrepreneurs do need to traverse the different boundaries of the overall economy and overall society to develop sustainable careers. They can't sit still in one place because the work won't come to them, the ideas won't come to them, and certainly the market won't come to them. So we're seeing increasingly creative entrepreneurs working across different sectors, working with different partners, whether it's partners in the technology sector, partners in science, etc., to develop new platforms, new types of content, new business models. And we're seeing, I think, particularly post-digital, we're seeing creative entrepreneurs operating as much as service providers as direct providers of products and content. So you apply a creative mind to a problem. You engage creative practitioners, whether they be artists or designers, to unpack a particular technology that you have introduced, because they will come at it from a different perspective and they might see something you haven't. And in turn, that might drive innovation in one direction, or it might help you to develop a use for something which in turn can be monetized. So the notion of creative entrepreneurs as service providers is changing. And there's quite a lot of research here, been undertaken here, for example, by the Crafts Council in the UK, which has tried to unpick how creatives become service providers or enablers of convergence across the economy. So in the way that they think, they bring cyclical thinking to scientists' more linear approach, for example. The way they engage with society, the way they have to be connected to the zeitgeist, have to understand the pulse of a place. And of course, in terms of the skills, the ability to visualize complexity, the ability to see something which others don't see. So they're increasingly a resource that perhaps has been undertapped in our economies. And as part of this, they can be quite technologically curious. Exploring the boundaries of a technology in ways that we perhaps wouldn't otherwise envisage. And when you broker relationships between certain types of creative, particularly creative entrepreneurs who are also thinking about the end game, the business model, the product, and the market, you start to see new uses for technologies that weren't previously seen. So on one level, they're driving shift because they're people, they're picking up technology and using it in ways that perhaps we hadn't envisaged. On another level, they're responding to shift, responding to new technologies and trying to adapt those to their business models. As we see at the moment with the astonishing amount of change that's happening in the publishing sector and the way that to some extent creatives are kind of victims of that, they're helpless. But on another level, they're also driving new business models that come out of the digitalization of the notion of the book. And that in turn creates a new paradigm, and some people will ultimately benefit financially from that as well as in other ways. Okay, I'll miss that bit out. Actually, maybe I won't. And of course, the point to make here is that things are only getting faster. And notionally, if creatives are hungry for working with new and emerging technologies, if they're building increasingly globalized networks enabled through digital, and if they're collaborating across those boundaries. So, this is the first generation where a creative entrepreneur in Brazil can work on a project with a creative entrepreneur in the north of Portugal and somebody in China, etc. Then you're starting to get incredible new possibilities in terms of the development of new kinds of content, new kinds of business model, etc. And it's only going to get faster. But at the same time, being respondent to shift, we're also seeing a kind of slowdown where a lot of creative entrepreneurs are seeing the market is in slowness as well as in speed. So developing almost ultra-local products, experiences, businesses that respond to the very distinctive context of a local place as a response to this sort of dizzying speed of digital. So they have to be agile, I guess is what I'm saying here. And they have to survive, to wash their face as businesses. They have to be open and they have to take risks that you wouldn't perhaps take in other sectors. And that creates all sorts of challenges, for example, in investment. So how do you invest in a creative business with high amount of intangible assets, where creativity is the main driver, where the market is as yet underdetermined? How do you do all of those things? Because they're seen as risky. And of course they are risky, because they are taking risks as a core discipline. So we have to think about cleverer ways of investing in them if we're all going to benefit from that risk taking. Okay, so those are some stereotypes about creative entrepreneurs and how they function, how they operate. Only stereotypes. And this is the kind of thing they're balancing all of the time. Their own creativity, developing new kinds of value, and trying to do so in a way that doesn't compromise their own identity, but at the same time builds value, whether it's commercial value or social value, etc., through collaboration. So how do we enable creative entrepreneurs to flourish? How do we support people who are working in that kind of world to grow their businesses and to play a role in knowledge creation, in innovation, and society as a whole? Last year we did a piece of work for the Arts Council in England where they asked us to look at the relationship between the arts and the commercial creative industries. But more broadly they were asking us to explore ways that infrastructure, particularly in the arts sector, so culture houses, etc., but also in the education sector, our universities, they asked us to look at how they can play a more appropriate role in enabling creative entrepreneurs to flourish in society, directly in terms of the way they operate as creative industries businesses, but also indirectly in terms of the value they can offer to other processes in society. For example, in the innovation ecosystem of a city, or, for example, in the delivery of public services, those kinds of things. And very crudely in that piece of work, we talked about the ecology, which is all of the different things that are out there that characterize, for example, the distinctiveness of Aveiro, the institutional, social, cultural distinctiveness of this city. And then the economy, which is the sort of monetization of the outcomes of those distinctive points of interconnection that are embedded in a place. And we talked about how we need to get it right at the top in terms of providing an appropriate ecology if we're ever going to get the bottom line economic value out of the sector. And that too often, with creative industries policy, for example, we've been mobilised by the bottom by, for example, providing specialist business support services or trying to develop business angel networks for the creative sector, or developing classic incubation models where we put the creative businesses all together and hope that they grow, all of those kinds of things. What we should have been doing is focusing on the top, which is about getting the basics right and providing the enabling conditions for creatives to flourish. And that means trying to find some fundamental answers to this question, which is creative infrastructure. Simple as that. Is it effective? Is it delivering what we need? Is it fit for purpose? And the stereotypes also exist here in terms of our creative infrastructure, the role of a university, the role of an arts house, art centre, etc. So a university like Aveiro, actually it's quite a new university, so it hasn't got such a deeply embedded organisational memory as some universities or some arts houses, but they all have a sense of themselves and what they're for and why they were started and what their role is in society. And these actually have quite significant sunk costs and investments. It's often quite difficult to move them around, to open them up, to create new understandings, new types of memory. And to survive, a university, which also has to operate more as a business, or an art centre, theatre, gallery, which has to look for a diversity of income streams increasingly to survive, they have to develop strong brands. There has to be a kind of, cultural and intellectual authenticity at the heart of what they do. And there has to be a level of robustness in protecting the value of that brand. Now, if that brand was created a generation ago, that creates challenges in terms of that institution being effective and applicable for today's opportunities and challenges. A university or a culture house has to have privileged knowledge at their heart. So there has to be a sense of this being creating something which wouldn't be possible elsewhere, wouldn't be possible necessarily outside of these walls or outside of this institutional reach. Privilege is a key defining factor for education institutions and culture houses. It doesn't mean social closure, but it means a sense that you're getting something much stronger, better, etc., than you would somewhere else. That's great, but that also creates challenges when it comes to reform and innovation. You have to have a clear audience, a sense of yourself, a sense of who you are for, what you are for. Whether it's, you know, the kind of classic student relationship, whether it's about understanding who, if you're a theatre, understanding who your core audience is and who comes to that institution. There's always, in an education institution or in a culture house, a strong departmental culture. The institutions are designed hierarchically, historically at least, are designed to have all of the structures that create blockages at exactly the right point for sustainability and for effective line management. And you have the same issue in municipalities and other large publicly driven organisations. This is, some of you will recognise this, is dark matter in space. Now, this is an analogy used by this guy, Wouter Vantisvoud, which is a brilliant name, who talks about the dark matter in institutions and the challenge of crossing boundaries. And actually, you could say this applies to corporations as well. That the way that they're historically designed, the way that hierarchies are institutionalized, can create challenges in terms of how you move rapidly between departments, the way that you can develop transformational interdisciplinary activities. It's difficult. So when we have an institution trying to do this kind of stuff, trying to break down the boundaries, it's really, really damn difficult. Really hard to do. It's really hard to develop things like incubation activities that genuinely embed incubation across the institution rather than just where the incubation is supposed to happen. I'm sure that doesn't happen here. I'm sure it's marvellous. But these are challenges that we all face, I think, when we're trying to support creative entrepreneurs to flourish. And of course, that creates inertia. It reduces the agility, the flexibility of institutions to move with the sector they're seeking to support. A kind of inert fortress stereotype of a university there. And in some ways, the kind of planning, the mechanisms, the interfaces are yesterday's interfaces. You know, the old kind of notice board approach to informational flow. Is that appropriate for today? And even the digital notice boards sometimes feel a bit anachronistic. And of course there are challenges here as well, because it's not the institution's fault half of the time. So in the work we were doing for the Arts Council, the fault ultimately is the investment landscape, it's the funder. Because the institutions are desperate to open up and find new ways of working with the sector. They really want to be flexible and they want to create a nurturing environment for creatives to flourish. But it's really hard when your funders themselves have their own rules and their own organisational memories and their own prejudices and their own inertia, their own bureaucracies. And it's even harder when you've got lots of funders, each with their own inertia and way of seeing, way of doing. So that doesn't help things either. And there are other kinds of balancing acts that institutions are trying to play when it comes to supporting creative entrepreneurs. For example, the notion of education versus skills, how we embed creativity as a kind of holistic attribute to all of our education, from school into university, how we get people to use both sides of their brains through their education, versus skills. So how do we build the technical skills that are required for the market? How do we build relationships with businesses that are out there in the market so they can work with our graduates before they graduate so that they're ready for the industry when they do graduate. The trouble is, do they develop the skills now because they will be out of date when they get into the market? So there's all those issues around how we build relationships and the kind of feedback loops that are required between institutions of education and institutions of commerce and institutions of culture. There are also challenges in terms of the kind of social responsibility that's placed upon a lot of our institutions, at universities, houses of culture. They have to protect their own interests, but they are kind of vehicles of civic development, of social capital and civil society. So that creates other kinds of pressure. Not just how you support your graduate, but also how you play an enabling role across your city, for example, in terms of inspiring your communities, or in terms of agendas such as regeneration and inward investment. How does a university play a role as the kind of attack brand and driver of change for the whole city? And that carries a huge institutional burden for the university. And the same kind of pressure is often placed on theatres and galleries, etc. And this one, culture versus commerce, or knowledge versus money. These are, you know, creating all sorts of identity crises within our institutional landscape in Portugal and elsewhere. We want to do it for all the right reasons. We want to create value from the intrinsic pursuit of knowledge and cultural edification. But we also need to make sure this economy doesn't sink any further. We need to drive other kinds of value out of that process. And that is challenging. And that creates kind of to some extent, real institutional dilemmas when it comes to how they can provide effective environments for their creative talent to work. And ultimately, whatever we do, however much we invest, because of those issues I've talked about, our institutions, our art centres, our universities are always going to be playing catch-up to some extent, because society is whizzing around outside of their doors, and it's very hard for them to provide the kind of environment that the creatives who are part of that society can actually benefit from. So there's a lot of initiatives at the moment, for example, around building digital capacity within our institutions. There's a big programme in the UK with the BBC and the Arts Council. They recognise that our bricks and mortar cultural institutions, our historically embedded institutions, were not sufficiently digitally literate for them to provide the kind of experiences and services that our creative talent needs if it's to flourish. So are our institutions fit for purpose in terms of providing the kind of enabling environment our creative talent needs? Are they sufficiently digital? Digitally enabled, digitally literate? Have they the digital capacity? Have they the connectivity? Do they have the knowledge, the know-how, and the entrepreneurial spirit? And sometimes we get bogged down in this. And sometimes institutions are too busy trying to respond to this sort of digital urgency without actually engaging with the sector effectively to work out what it is that the sector needs. Oops. This is going crazy. I like this quote because this suggests the kind of junction that our cultural institutions have reached when it comes to how they make the most of existing and emergent technologies for them to build deeper and richer relationships with their public, be they creative businesses or audiences. And the notion that we are at this critical juncture, crucial juncture, where a place with all of the historical integrity, like a culture house, like a university, a place of that brand is actually in a unique position to become the broker, or a broker, of the kind of flows of knowledge, of aspiration, of ideas that are so important for future business models to be created and for us to make the most of our creative talent. They're in a brilliant position to do that. The challenge is how they do it. And we should talk about, I'll talk about some of the ways perhaps of doing that. But what the digital does, of course, it shifts the relationships, if I haven't already said this just now. It shifts the relationship, for example, between producer and consumer. The notion of the audience, actually, this looks like you. The notion of the audience has changed. You know, you are yourself producers, you are interacting, some of you might be tweeting, this is going out on Facebook, etc. The audience is not as it used to be. Oops. And more than that, obviously, we're just really in the kind of foothills now of new markets and new ways of producing. Where, you know, in terms of, you know, for example, whether it's around printing or whether it's about social media, the conversation has changed. And that creates challenges for institutions to be at the heart of the conversation rather than to the margins of the conversation. But that means it changes the way we build relationships on a daily basis. The relationship between student and teacher has changed. Who's teaching who? I don't know. The notion of how we build cultural programs. So if you're a theatre, you don't think about providing for your audience. You think about how you work with your audience. It's a subtle, but actually, I think, quite dramatic shift, because we can now have so many different points of contact with our audience, and we can develop depth with real reach at the same time. So with. When we research, when we develop new knowledge. Now, historically, there's a lot more analysis and synthesis, but of course now we can work collectively to create knowledge and create new ways of seeing that historically would have been very difficult to do. So that shifts the whole focus of the pure pursuit of knowledge within a university, but also it shifts the way that cultural institutions create knowledge about their city. Goodness me. Okay. So in that context of shift, of change, are we giving every opportunity for new business models to emerge inside the institution, but also for the businesses that feed off us, that build relationships with us? And this is a quote I've used unapologetically now for about 5 years, and I think it's as relevant now as it was 5 years ago, by Sir Geoffrey Cossack. So what is needed is not new or adapted instruments for knowledge transfer, but something quite different, the spaces in which interactions can take place. We need to open up our institutions, we need to build or create new spaces that are beyond our normal way of doing, and see what happens. The spaces between. And you're probably sick to death, as I am, of hearing Steve Jobs quotes. But actually, this is the one that is relevant in this context, because it's the only thing I can think of that's relevant for the arts sector and the education sector at the same time, because it talks about the two things and how there has to be a synergy, has to be a serendipity between what we do in a university and what we do in a culture centre outside. Because it's the marriage of technology with the liberal arts and humanities that yields the result that makes our hearts sing. And that's the kind of stuff from which business models emerge. They don't emerge in the lab, they emerge through the energy and the kind of joy of reciprocal thinking and co-creation of new ideas, new content. So in that context, what does this mean for the north of Portugal? How do we provide that kind of open, enabling environment in this part of the world? And what does that mean for things like a campus? What does that mean for the fixed sunk costs of an institution such as a university? It's challenging. So we need, ultimately, some new and adapted instruments to do that. So these are kind of adapted instruments. These are examples of incubators, knowledge exchange projects, where the universities are trying to open up their offer for creative entrepreneurs. So they, you know, they provide them with the kind of business and management support that, that creative entrepreneurs would have benefited from earlier on in their career. They provide you with the kind of privileged knowledge that might help you be more market ready when you leave the academy. And there are some quite interesting sort of next generation or next phase models emerging, such as in Goldsmiths in South East London, the Institute for Creative and Cultural Entrepreneurship, trying to build that holistic approach to making the most of creative talent. And so there's a whole program around social engaged practice, and then there's a whole program here about how you commercialize your creativity to develop sustainable businesses. And in between, there are all sorts of programs about how you build relationships between different parts of the university and the society to make the most of the creative talent as almost like service providers for the overall economy. And we see this in the arts. No longer are you just a theatre or a cinema. You can't be that. You've got to be all of these things coming together. You've got to be this crossroads, this junction between the physical and the digital, between production and consumption, between different art forms, between knowledge and culture. You can't survive without developing this hybrid, syncretic approach to creativity. And there's some uber examples like the National Theatre in London, which is different ways is trying to open up its building to try and demystify, first of all, what a theatre is all about, but also to create a sense of this being somewhere you can be engaged with, trying to find different points of contact, different ways to provide feedback and build different relationships with the institution. So opening up the institution. Oops. And we see it with something like NT Live, which is a very basic business model, but it's using digital to commercialise that which has only historically been possible as a sort of live experience. So they're basically just broadcasting their product internationally in places like cinemas and other theatres, but using digital technology to basically reach many more people, but also to shift their relationship. So all sorts of ways of commentating and responding to the content online and live. So you're building new surfaces almost for what is a live piece of theatre. And at the same time, you're building new revenue streams. So opening up the institution. We see this in other models, such as the new network of cross-art form venues in the UK. Focusing on the spaces between normal business and historically embedded practice. All institutions are innovative. All institutions are going through some process of evolution and change and innovation. Most institutions, historically, it feels a little bit like that, pushing the boulder uphill, not really making the kind of progress that is necessary for the institution to retain the fitness for purpose that it had when it first opened its doors. And some things, like digital, do accelerate that process, or sometimes it means the boulder just comes crashing down on you again and again and again. There are processes of building in innovation, of developing regulated innovation to try to just keep up to speed, or at least run to stand still in the changing world. So things like in the UK, like the Cultural Leadership Programme, building capacity, building knowledge within the cultural sector so that they were at least at pace with or understood the kind of context of shift that they were in. And then you get the kind of more incremental intervention, the kind of more mission-driven innovation that I guess the leading organisations all have, where they basically free up capacity, investment, space to push for change as a kind of core practice on a day-to-day basis. Not just management away days and all that kind of stuff, but absolutely building it into the process. And then you get open innovation, of course, which is, this is a slide I've stolen from my colleague Dan Hill, who works for something called Citra Studios in Finland. And Finland, perhaps more than anywhere else in Europe, understands the notion of open innovation. So this is where innovation isn't seen as a kind of an extra or a kind of privileged discipline. This is something that is embedded as a core practice at the heart of institutional practice. So Citra, which is the kind of innovation lab for effectively the Finnish public policy creation, sits within government and drives change from within rather than being a kind of innovation unit outside. And this has parallels, I think, in terms of how we plan our universities and our cultural sector. And then if we think about that question, how do we support creative entrepreneurs? We think we need a little bit of radical innovation as well. And this is not just about the adaptation. This is about the conscious delivery of change, the conscious delivery of transformation. And in the cultural sector, again, I make no apologies in using this example most times I speak. And this is Watershed in Bristol, in the southwest of England. Started life as a kind of media centre, one of the first media centres in the 80s, which sounds so dated now, if you think about it. It's in an old industrial shed by the water, by the floating harbour. Then it became more of an art house, cinema, and a place of real distinction and cultural capital in that city. But it had to keep moving, and it had to not just have an approach towards kind of incremental innovation, not even just open innovation. They consciously said, we want to be a place that fosters radical innovation for our city. And we want to do that in a way that supports our creative talent to take centre stage in everything that we do. And we don't see ourselves as an arts centre or a cultural centre. We see ourselves as a driver of economic and social change for the overall city in which we're based. And to do that, we need to make sure that we provide as much support as possible and as much capacity and freedom and confidence as possible to our creative talent, so they feel free to play with us. So this is the director of this place saying, we're most interested in collisions of experience and cultures to create something new. A laboratory for experiment, etc., etc. A commitment to open innovation from what could otherwise be quite a successful art house cinema. They could have stayed the same, but they chose not to. And they chose not to because they recognised that there was so much capital to be made by really opening up and really going for it. And they've played a pivotal role in making Bristol what it is today, which is a real centre for the creative industries, but also more widely for technology and wider knowledge-based industries. And they are kind of part of the kind of oil and the glue for that city that's helped to bring together, for example, HP Labs, Toyota have got their labs there, the two universities, the social community sector, the arts and cultural sector, and all of the freaks and the geeks and the independent individual creative entrepreneurs that are out there in that city. If you go into their cafe now and you ask somebody what they're doing or who they are or what they're all about, they're probably running their business from there because it becomes a physical space to connect as well as the kind of place digitally to connect through their various platforms. And it's about engaging with the DNA of the city, understanding place, and then working out how you translate that into your new mission as an institution. And as part of that, as part of that conversation with the city, they've introduced new innovations as a way of retaining a relevance in that city. So the pervasive media studio, if you remember, it's grown out of what was an art house cinema, is, they call it the tech play lab for the city. And this is basically, on one level, it's flexible workspace where you're basically free to play and you're encouraged to collaborate. And part of the rules of being there, and you have to give up your time and your energy to work with other people who are there to see what happens, just to connect. And there are people in there from artists to engineers to technologists to scientists, and they're all there for the same mission, which is to create something new from the combinations of things that are happening in there. But it's also, on top of that, you need programming. So there's commissioning, budgets, there are social events, there are all sorts of things that basically hack into the knowledge and creativity and social capital of the different people in that room, but also the people who are part of the kind of wider network of the pervasive media studio to create new things, new business models, based on the combination of their assets. And that was almost a forerunner for what is happening now in that city, which I think is interesting because it could be the sort of thing that would work well in northern Portugal. Because that was almost the pilot for what we have now, which is a new level of partnership, new level of investment. So INET Southwest Creative Industries Programme is something funded through the Arts and Humanities Research Council in the UK. And it's a combination of different institutional partners working to invest in those spaces between, I was talking about, to create something new, which is an effective ecology for creative entrepreneurs to flourish within. So these are the partners. There's about £5 million being spent to invest in projects that do all of the things I just mentioned. And this is what they say they're doing. Looking at all stages in the innovation cycle. Now what's interesting here is that they're universities trying to develop new functions, new services. Watershed, Pervasive Media Labs, are one of the partners as well. So the arts and cultural sector is coming together with the education sector, is coming together with business to do this. And one of the things that I think is particularly interesting is that they recognise that at the heart, or the engine really, of all of this is the collision of new technologies and the technologists who are playing with the new technologies and driving change and the creatives. And if you get that right, that's where the business models will be that will help to scale up the growth of that sector in the future. And they all have all sorts of programs like boot camps, and they have commissions, and they have an investment readiness and investment program looking at smart commissioning, again, in the spaces between, investing in things that the market wouldn't normally invest in. On the basis that this demonstrates the opposite of that, this hopefully, through the evidence it generates, the partnership it cements, and the confidence it gives, will show that you can make investments in the creative sector, which are not doing that, but actually are around growth and sustainability. And if you provide the kind of institutional capacity that is required, then you provide the environment in which risk is reduced, which is really key, because the creative industries is so often under-resourced because people think it's too risky. So the world is changing. And it's interesting that, I mean, HP Lab have just reduced their offer in that city, but they moved to Bristol because of the combination of talent and institutional openness that I've just been describing there. There are other projects that are exploring these spaces between. For example, in socially engaged practice, the University of the Arts London has got this new project called Peckham Space, which is about, it's a brand new permanent art space, project space, community space in a quite a deprived part of southeast London. And this is about supporting their artists, their pre-graduate and also their staff to develop socially engaged practice in the diverse communities of southeast London through this platform. So it's not all about the technology, it's also just about the relationships you try to build as an institution. Corner House in Manchester, historically another art house cinema, was taken upon itself to become the kind of curator of the overall creative class in that city. They run the network, they drive the news, They are the broker and the connector for creative talent across the city through the Creative Times publication. There are new models of workspace. Gone of the old models of managed workspace, everyone sitting at their desks. We're looking at very flexible models of creative workspace now, like the hub models. I think there's a hub in Lisbon. But these are just basically based upon things like the business model for gymnasiums. You know, so that if everyone turned up at the same time, you'd never get to do any exercise. But the idea is that you build a network and you leverage the value of that network to inhabit this kind of space. So very informal, very funky, very open. And this potentially is the future of workspace. So what is the future of, you know, what is the role of an arts institution or a university in providing fit for purpose spaces for people to come together, for the network to come together? DocFest in Sheffield in the UK has grown from being a very boutique documentary film festival to become incredibly, I guess the second biggest documentary film festival in the Northern Hemisphere now. And the way they've done that is by being really cross-platform, really international, but also somehow very local. It still feels very local, very intimate, but they have speakers that are obviously that are from all over the world. They commission projects that partner institutions from different disciplines, and they create new content every year based upon the combination of distinctive talents that they've commissioned. Another project, I won't go into them in any more detail, except to say, if you don't know about this place already, watch out for it. Has anybody heard about the Centre for Night? Okay, so this is Geoffrey Crossick, who I quoted earlier on. This is his new baby in King's Cross in London. And this is basically a special purpose vehicle, which is all about exploring the spaces between. It's about commissioning projects that would otherwise not be commissioned, particularly looking at the interface between technology, art, and science. And it's too early to see what will happen, but I think it will be very interesting to see what kind of outcomes they have from that and what that means in terms of innovation, business models, etc. And of course, I guess the mission there is, can we develop our own, you know, MIT in Europe? Can we develop the kind of success stories that institution's delivered, but through our own distinctive assets, leveraging our own identity and knowledge base? And to do that, we need to focus on building our capacity, driving our innovation capacity, and making relationships between the ideation, the creative process, and the economy. I'm going to skip this because I'll kill you if I keep talking about those things. Okay. Second major example, something that is live for us at the moment. We're currently working as learning partners for the Creative Scotland Digital Development Programme. I thought this might be an interesting parallel to Portugal as well, as a programme that is, I guess, again, looking beyond adapted instruments towards something new, something different, something necessary. So they've got a programme that tries to connect all of the, I guess, the development needs you might have as a cultural organisation in terms of making the most of digital technology. And they try to sort of connect them together as an overall coherent programme through very bespoke, packaged up projects. So Ambition Scotland, that's the kind of basic innovation programme. This is specialised support, coaching, mentoring for people working across the cultural sector in Scotland to lift their digital capacity. From really simple stuff like making the most of social media as an arts organisation, through to perhaps more radical stuff, you know, around, for example, how you co-create projects with your audiences. So there's a programme of development support as part of it. Then we get into the more messy, experimental, radical stuff. So there's this SYNC programme, developed, for example, a programme of geeks in residence. This is, you know, getting your people who are interested in electronics and people who never open their curtains even in the summer, all those people, to work with your arts and cultural organisations to test the boundaries of what they have. So an interesting programme, Geeks in Residence. There's also a series of culture hack events where they bring together different parts of the cultural sector and just basically platform it to see what happens when they play together. Institutions that historically were like this, and perhaps they were competing for funding, they're certainly competing for audiences. So what happens when you throw them all together? And we shall see, because it's only just started. And on top of this, the thing that focuses on the gaps that those two programmes, Ambition and Culture Hack, don't deliver, is a new digital development fund. So this looks at the kind of pure stuff that wouldn't normally be funded. This is commissioning arts organisations to work with scientists to do something they didn't or wouldn't previously be able to do. And interestingly, this is where universities are working with the arts and cultural sector and with other sectors to put in bids for projects. These three elements together, what it all becomes is a kind of demonstration platform for what happens when you invest the spaces between sectors, but ultimately the goal is to build the digital capacity of the sector so that it can more effectively serve and support the creative economy to flourish. And it connects to other parts of the ecology of business support and creative development in the country. So what does this mean for the future? And what does this mean for this region, perhaps, in particular? Going back to this slide, how do we more effectively connect the assets that we have in this region, our universities, our businesses, our cultural centres? And how do we make sure there isn't a disconnect between that and supporting our creative entrepreneurs to flourish at the heart of the overall offer? So if you think about the kind of classic creative entrepreneur stereotype, they need access to markets, they need to understand the legal environment, they need to access knowledge, they need support with business support and planning, they need access to finance, all that kind of stuff. But what they need most is an opportunity to collaborate, to develop and to share risks, and they need to be positioned confidently as critical agents of change for the society and for the economy that we're working within. And I think often the bottom right-hand side is completely forgotten. We see them as kind of units of economic development. And if you really want to, if you want to make the most of them as that, you've got to attend to the distinctive social and cultural needs that they have. So our future cultural and education institutions are going to look like whatever a digital version of that looks like. They need to be many things at the same time, and they need to have new tools ready for tomorrow's demands, rather than trying to reuse old tools for tomorrow. You know, it's like we do find ourselves, I think, today trying to use yesterday's tools for today's challenges. And I know that there are reasons for that, and I took you through some of them, but sometimes we need to create some new tools as well. There's some interesting new models where we're based in the East End of London. We've seen a gradual social development with artists, creative entrepreneurs, cultural institutions, diverse communities have created a scene, a buzz, an energy. So anybody who's been to Shoreditch or Hoxton in East London will recognise that as a creative, energetic place where business and culture come together. The task now is to leverage that a little bit more to grow those businesses. The university sector are playing a key role. Larger businesses like Google, Microsoft are coming into play. But we mustn't forget the overall ecology. There's a danger there that the big boys come in and the little things start to go away again. We need to find a way of nurturing the ecology at the same time as delivering economic growth. And that's really challenging. This is just incidentally an interesting way of mapping that cluster. So this is basically based on the density of Twitter feeds that businesses in the creative and media sector are generating. And it gives you a different sense of the energy of the area than a standard business location map would give you. So in the north of Portugal, we need to come back to these fundamental questions. And as part of the answer to that question, we need to think about what the role of the universities are, the role of our arts and cultural sector. We don't want to replicate. We don't want to just develop what other people have done. We need to do something that is absolutely true to your own specific context. Oops. And we need to go back to basics as well. We need to think about why people get involved in creative industries and things in the first place. They do so because there's a kind of culture of aspiration in their city or in their society. And institutions like universities or the theatre or whatever need to absolutely generate that culture of aspiration so that there is that kind of sense of anything is possible in this city, in this institution. And they need to be much more effective hubs of social capital. Not just the social capital that's generated within an institution, but all the stuff that flies through a city. We need to find a way of much more effectively leveraging that. Okay, I'll move on from that. I just want to finish just by doing a bit of an advertisement, really, for what we're doing in Guimarães. Because as I said earlier on, this is really our opportunity to play with some of these agendas, but in a real city environment. And it's a kind of living lab, if we can use that phrase anymore. It's certainly a platform for experimentation. And what we're trying to do through the CIDAD program is to build relationships between activities that historically are underconnected. We're focusing on the spaces between the institutions, and we're focusing on the relationship between practice and developing the economy. Because an outcome of this, we hope, is to lift capacity, connectivity, and confidence, so that if you're a creative entrepreneur in that city, you tomorrow will feel that there is a possibility of playing, of taking part, and of building a business in that environment. So a few projects in that context where we're trying to do that are the Laboratorio de, I can't even pronounce that, I won't even try, LCD. So this is our, these are our geeks, but we've got our geeks here working with communities across the city, but also creative businesses to try to do new things. So they've run, over this year, they're running over 200 workshops, putting together loads of different, it's 200 or 100, putting together loads of different people from the humanities, from science, from arts, to try out new things in that city. We've got a fine lab who hasn't, but this is importing the guys from Opa Lab in Porto to the Guimarães context. But these are like our service providers across the programme, where they're working to develop new ways of imagining the city, really. And they're providing, and they're developing new content for the city, almost as tools, as provocations for our programme. We have OnOff, which is our most pure open innovation platform. Does anybody here know Mouse Abutos in Porto, yeah? I guess some of you know. So it's those guys, but we've said to you, you can't just do what you do in Porto, you've got to do something that is absolutely engaged with the distinctive elements in this city. So this is a work in progress. They're there at the moment, they're on, and they're commissioning artists from Brazil, from Galicia, from north of Portugal. They're working with the education sector, working with the textile sector, working with micro creatives. Again, we shall see what happens, but I'm sure it will be very exciting. We have a more commercially focusing programme, a talent development programme, feeding off all of that messy collaboration stuff to spot talent and to try to give it some basic support in terms of business development. So there's a kind of acceleration programme, workshops, mentoring for creative talent in the city. We have a fashion programme working with historic textile industries, but also some of the really, really interesting emergent fashion talent in the city. And the idea is that we build a kind of new collection that showcases the fashion talent in the city and the region as a whole. But we do so in a way that builds relationships with the textile sector. So in turn, hopefully, the textile sector will be more flexible, open and innovative in the future. So they, for example, will do shorter production runs, which historically they haven't been able to do, because they'll be building a relationship with the fashion talent. And we're working with the University of Minho as part of that, so that there's an outcome of this is a more structured approach to fashion development in the city in the future. We have an Open Cities project, which is looking at open governance, open data, open technology, and it's exploring, for example, how we develop a city in the future where the conversation is much more democratic, where ownership of the agenda is much more inclusive. And this comes right down to basic stuff, like how do we map the city? So we've got this project here, these balloons, which is with an artist called James Bridle, who's been running workshops with LCD in the city. And we're remapping the city in 2 weeks' time by launching little cameras with these balloons and basically walking around the city to create an alternative map of the city, again, fusing different disciplines to ask questions about who owns the landscape of the city, who owns the narrative of Guimarães, opening up the city. And we have an agenda around smaller cities. So places like Guimarães, Aveiro, these are not the metropolis. These are proudly small and distinctive cities. Now that means we need to do things that are on our terms. And that means when we come to things like, what does growth mean? Or what should a university be doing? Or what can an art centre do? These are not, the answers to those questions will not be found in London or Paris or Tokyo or whatever. They'll be found in other smaller cities like it. So we're trying to build collaboration with other smaller cities to build a knowledge base and to build a conversation and a network so that there is that exchange of ideas and of practice in the future. And in that sense, we make the smaller city the mainstream when it comes to approaches to economic development and cultural planning. And we're launching a website, it's not very old-fashioned. We're launching a kind of new platform to build that conversation, and the cities that are part of that will be contributing to it. And I'd welcome everybody to take part in that. And ultimately, this is what we're trying to do in Guimarães, but this is what I think we should be trying to do here and in other cities, is to go beyond the basics and to enable our creatives to self-actualize. Helps them to grow as businesses, but it helps the overall economy itself to diversify, to be more balanced, to be more inclusive, and also, obviously, to grow. And in a smaller town like here, when the university and the arts and cultural sector get together, we need to think about doing it on our own terms. We need to think about some of the stuff which perhaps gets historically lost when it comes to the rationale for things like investment in knowledge transfer projects and all that kind of stuff. We need to think about value and not just quick wins. Sustainability and excellence. And ultimately, it's about collectively trying to reimagine what is possible here. And if you think about it by extension, reimagine the possibility of the university or the possibility of the arts and cultural house. And that is the kind of major agenda, I think, that we should be attending to for the creative entrepreneur. This is a very old quote now, but I think it's still a pertinent quote for this agenda. So if we are to make the most of our talent, and if we are to put our creative people to the heart of the way that we plan our institutions, the way that we invest in our future, then it's about building that open, collaborative relationship and building, I guess, new platforms, new tools to do that, to have that relationship. So that's probably more than enough from me. Thank you for listening. And I guess we kind of relax into questions now, don't we, in discussion and things like that. Yeah? Okay, so thank you very much.
Okay, so now it's the time for questions. The thing goes as follows. Either you ask or I have to ask for you, and that's quite embarrassing. So let's have some questions here, people. No, you're embarrassing me now. No questions, for Christ's sake.
Hello, my name is Francisco. I would like to know more details about how everything you have talked was about concepts, too much conceptual. I would like to know details how it was implemented in Guimarães, the projects from the start to now.
In Guimarães?
Guimarães.
Okay. Yeah. I'm never going to pronounce that. It builds on some work that I was working about 4 or 5 years ago now as part of the team that developed the creative economy strategy for the north of Portugal, which was a European funded program that was trying to basically identify what the strengths were of the sector in the north of Portugal and then to develop mechanisms and an investment plan to support the growth of the sector afterwards, to make the most of its potential. And as part of that, I was working with different municipalities and I was consulting basically with different players, so universities, arts and cultural institutions like Sorales, Casa de Música, we talked to as well, and to build a sense of what is possible in the north of the country. And then Guimarães got the title of European Capital of Culture. So the then team asked me to if I wanted to be involved in basically in helping them to plan the program, but also as a kind of advocate and champion of the program. And I said yes, on the basis that this, if this could be an opportunity to experiment and do stuff that you wouldn't normally do in a European capital of culture. I couldn't program music or theatre or anything like that, so you know, that would, regardless, I would have been out of my depth. But I suggested that there's an opportunity here to ask bigger questions about the city, about the economy, and about the role of culture in society about in that particular city, and to use that as a demonstrator for all of those issues for other cities, and also to do something in a way that would build capacity and confidence so that next year things are still happening as an outcome of this kind of accelerated program of investment and development. So then I thought about, okay, how do we plan, how do you design something that covers the key areas of creative economy development, innovation ecosystem, institutional reform? And so I came up with broadly, crudely, three different program areas. One is landscape. So it's about how we transform or ask questions about the physical and the digital landscape of our city. And that's where we've got things like pop-up projects, looking at the future of retail. We've got arts commissions in difficult industrial spaces, which are asking questions about who's this space for, what it can become, all that kind of thing. Then the second theme is exchange. So this is basically using the creative, the capital of culture as an excuse to invest in collaboration where it wouldn't ordinarily happen, or where it would happen slowly and invisibly. So that's where things like on-off come in. We can do a high-profile collaboration commissioning process. Or that's where the Fashion Hub project comes in, because we can leverage the brand and the profile of European capital of culture to get the university and the textile industry to play together in ways that they wouldn't normally do, or they'll wait for so long that you wouldn't, in normal time, be able to do that kind of activity. Because of some of the things I mentioned before about how institutions move so slowly, in industry, for example, traditional manufacturing in the textile industry move very slowly. So let's use this as an opportunity to do something really quick and to speed up the process and to show what happens when you do that. And then the third element is about future cities. So that's about knowledge in the city. So these are that's the Open Cities project and the Smaller Cities project. And there are kind of feedback loops looking at the other two areas, landscape and exchange, and trying to describe what's happening and to be critical about what's happening as well as positive. And this is where the knowledge development comes into play. So as an outcome in the Smaller Cities project, we will have an evaluation in a sense of what happens when you accelerate collaboration and do difficult and interesting things in a city, in a smaller city, every year. But also, I think as an outcome, there'll be partnerships that wouldn't have otherwise happened. And also, we're also starting to be able to attract investment to projects that wouldn't have otherwise happened because the project wouldn't have happened. So we've already got relationships with the Design Institute, which is a new public partnership between the city and the university, and we're going to have a fashion development program there next year, we're pretty confident of. So that's, you know, kind of real outcome stuff that's coming out of this. So does that in any way answer your question?
Yes, more or less. Right. Just one more question. Do you know if there were created sustainable business from these projects for now?
Without having a crystal ball, I couldn't tell you, but I certainly anticipate that some will, because what we've been able to do is to provide an environment where you can experiment more and where you can take risks more. And you know, that means that some will fail, but that's where we need to, you know, we almost need to encourage that failure as well. And then I think it's different to Aveiro in that it's a more conservative city, a more traditional city than Aveiro. So it's a place where people don't actually feel confident about taking risks. And if you fail, you lose face. Actually, this provides an opportunity to do some failing and to learn from that and to pick yourself up. And hopefully, if your business doesn't work this time round, you're better equipped for it to work the second time round. So some businesses will fail. Some will grow directly from this. And some will grow as an outcome in a year or two's time, because there'll be much more kind of energy and confidence in the city, we hope. It doesn't help that there's been a massive financial crisis in the middle of the process, but you know, I'm sure we're still positive.
More questions? I have a question regarding Aveiro, so this environment where you are right now. So imagine Aveiro, we don't have a really excellent excuse to actually, like Guimarães, we are not the capital of culture right now, so you just land here. So my question is, landing is in this really small city, what are your, well, they are not like, your crystal ball is not it's not going to help, but what are like your advices or the main keys that you are like looking to this city, looking to our institutions, looking to the dimension of the city and also our sectors in terms of private sectors and also public sectors, cultural all the cultural sector, the university, which is like really important. What are your main advices or like main keys for driving this change that you are actually now presenting us, that you are doing in Guimarães with an excellent excuse, but how can you do it in Aveiro without an excuse?
Okay. Well, I think you've probably got an excuse anyway, because we have the economic crisis, and I think there are also other kinds of crises which I started to point to. You know, the crisis of an institution like university. How does this university, which is quite young and created and is so central to the town and to the city and to its success, how can we ensure that it's absolutely central to the success of the city in the next generation? And that's you almost need to kind of create a sense of crisis to be able to push through the kind of reform that will make that, the kind of, will provide that kind of impact over the next generation of the town, because they're so linked together. I would say that go with your specialism is my major piece of advice wherever I go. Go with what it is that you're really good at. And so that means looking at the businesses that you have here that have probably clustered around certain levels of specialism, probably very much intimately linked to the university, have grown out of the university in different ways. And absolutely look at them and think about how they can become stronger, bigger, sharper, and more relevant in the next generation. That's the first thing. The second thing is actually to look again at whether the full breadth of the talent base of the city is being effectively engaged in the conversation and the support environment for things like business development. Or is it the same people who keep coming back for more? Are the networks too closed? Because even in a small city, and we saw this in Guimarães, it's amazing how closed the networks can be, which means the city is not making the most of its assets, its talent base, and by any means. And you don't need a good excuse to do that. You just need to make sure you get out there and connect with as much of the talent base as possible. And I think that any town that can really bring in all of their players, all the talent into play, will be in a special position when it comes to economic development and things like that. I suppose another element is about whether there's some really distinctive kind of cultural histories that you can make more of in Aveiro, but twist them into kind of contemporary elements. So whether you can make something around the kind of cultural history around tile making and around fishing and things like that, and to make that something that connects cultural tourism with smart business development, with creative industries development. So there's a kind of a lineage that's built upon the history of the city, but actually, so it has an authenticity in terms of the way that the future economy goes. I've only been here twice. This is the second time, so I'm guessing.
Okay, well, congratulations, it was a fantastic presentation. I have two small questions. First of all, is about the leadership, because most of these projects had a strong leadership. And you mentioned several types of leaderships. Here in Aveiro, we probably have different types of leaderships. We have the university, of course. We have the municipality. What kind of role can you? How could we develop an approach to this economic creativity strategy when you don't have a municipality with a strong leadership concerning this aspect? This is the first question. The second question is, it's about money. We have developed most of these projects with lots of money. Guimarães had the European Capital of Culture, so we have to change the paradigm. Mm. We have to do things with low cost, in a low cost approach. So probably that we have to change the way we do the projects. We manage to put people together. So This low-cost approach probably should help us or should drive us to another kind of projects and of collaborative work. And the final question, the third question, is the scale of the approach. We are in a region with 8 cultural centers in 20 miles distance. 8 cultural centers. This is, I think in Portugal, I don't remember a place with so much concentration. And probably the question is this the municipal scale the appropriate to develop these, or more a regional or a super municipal scale the most adequate to develop these projects and these ideas?
Okay, I'll try and answer in a way that links together those three questions. And typically, one of the slides I rushed over is probably in some ways links to this. I think that the leadership comes through partnership, particularly where there's an absence, as you say, if there is an absence of leadership within certain elements of the kind of institutional landscape of the city. So we're seeing a lot of new kinds of transsectoral and pan-institutional partnerships emerging, and not just in response to austerity, but I think in response to an appreciation of the way that historical boundaries are anachronistic, are no longer relevant. So the classic example, actually, which came out of European Capital of Culture in Liverpool, is something called Liverpool Arts and Regeneration Consortium. And that's where the two universities, the major culture houses, who have the physical buildings, but also the major cultural organisations, came together, at first informally, to share ideas, to talk about how they collectively can make a difference for the civic ambition or potential of that city. Very quickly, because of the downturn, but also because they have to survive as organisations, they started to talk about what that means, for example, around shared funding bids, but also about sharing costs so they can free up money for other things. So they looked at, I guess, what you'd call sharing efficiencies, but also sharing knowledge, sharing programmes, sharing each other's brands, all of that kind of stuff. And from that, they started to be able to attract investment, which they historically wouldn't have been able to do. So getting money from health, or from education, or from crime prevention, etc., into this institutional partnership. And obviously those sectors always have a lot more money than the cultural sector has. So they actually, it made a lot of economic sense. But I think the critical outcome of that is that it developed a new coherent leadership platform for a diversity of interests that historically were competing with one another or were ignorant of one another. And the binding factor was a passion for that city and making the most of that city as a place of culture and creativity and all those things. So that, I mean, that it's really hard, it's been really painful. And we're currently advising another city in the North of England to go through that process. And you get all sorts of issues around egos and around people in different, some people are less fortunate than others when it comes to the crisis and austerity. But the outcome ultimately is really valuable. And can attend to your issue around leadership. And also I think potentially can attend to your issue around the what we do with all this infrastructure, because in some ways, you know, there is a crisis because we have all of these sunk costs of buildings, particularly in the cultural sector, which then need audiences and they need to retain a freshness and a relevance. I was at the opening of the Plateforme des Arts in Guimarães last week, an amazing building. But obviously, you know, everybody knows that's going to be a hell of a challenge keeping that vibrant and all those different things in such a small town after European Capital of Culture. If you work collaboratively, there could be a network of those institutions working together to do all those things I mentioned, but also perhaps to do something different that isn't possible, whether it's around a new festival or whether it's around an innovation program or whatever it may be. But do something different to retain a relevance and to do something meaningful. So in some ways it's a problem having too many big cultural centres in such a tight geographical area, but actually there aren't many places like that, so see that as an opportunity to do something that you wouldn't be able to do in another place where there's one building or one organisation.
I think we have time for one more. Do you think the Guimarães program will extend to other Portuguese cities, like Aveiro? You talked about Northern Portuguese creativity program.
Yeah, but on one level, I mean, it's a demonstration. The project I'm working in, I can't speak for the whole European Capital of Culture program, and we're only a tiny, tiny part of it. But I certainly see this as a demonstration platform around small city making in culture and creativity. And I would hope then that Guimarães will work with other cities across the north of Portugal, but also already it's working with other smaller cities across Europe towards co-creation of agendas, knowledge exchange, and potentially doing projects together in the future. And I hope that that's something that they'll pick up on. And certainly in the next 6 months, as we go through the process of development into much more public delivery in the CIDAR programme, that's where we will need to be making relationships with Aveiro and with other cities in the north, and also looking at cities in Galicia, as I mentioned, Galicia, to build structured relationships that can live into the future. That's definitely the aspiration. But also I hope that it would galvanise other cities to say, well, we can do some of these things ourselves as well, and they're not actually that expensive. They just require a different way of working and a different way of seeing.
Okay. It's done. Thank you, John, being here.
Pleasure.
Great pleasure to have you in the university. I hope you come back one third time to see what we achieve with your knowledge and your questions.
I'd love to come back.
Thank you.
We
have
very much.
Just a small. As I think, you know, in Aveiro we have original
sweets. Wow. Oh,
okay.
Marvellous.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
And
that's dinner sorted then.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, great. It's a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Cheers.
Thank you.